Salvation of our souls, let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the good estate of the holy churches of God, and for the union of all men, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for those who with faith, reverence, and the fear of God entered therein, let us pray to the Lord. For our father, Metropolitan Joseph, for the venerable priesthood, the diaconate in Christ, for all the clergy and the people, let us pray to the Lord. For Metropolitan Paul and Archbishop John, and for their quick release from captivity and safe return, let us pray to the Lord. For the President of the United States, for all civil authorities, and for armed forces everywhere, especially for Peter, Ronnie, Andrew, Joshua, Connor, Benjamin, Thaddeus, and Adam, let us pray to the Lord. For this city and for every city and land, and for the faithful who dwell therein, for healthful seasons, for abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For travelers by sea, by land, and by air, for the sick and the suffering, for captives and for their salvation, for those under persecution for the faith, for our deliverance from all tribulation, wrath, danger, necessity, let us pray to the Lord. Help us, save us, have mercy upon us, and protect us, O God, by your grace. Calling to remembrance our all holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos, and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Sessions of the Theotokos, O Savior, save us. mercy on us and keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
All angels remember and throw holy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious, and anything else, O most and ever Virgin Mary. With all the saints, let us commit ourselves to each other and all of life unto Christ our God.
Christ our God, to thee, O Lord.
Lord, In those days, King Agrippa said to Paul, "You have permission to speak for yourself." Then Paul stretched out his hand and made his defense. "I journeyed to Damascus with the authority and commission of the chief priests. At midday, O king, I saw on the way a light from heaven, brighter than the sun, shining around me and those who journeyed with me. And when we had all fallen to the ground, I heard a voice saying to me in the Hebrew language, 'Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? It hurts you to kick against the goats.' And I said to him, 'Who art thou, Lord?' And the Lord said, 'I am Jesus whom you are persecuting. But rise and stand upon your feet, for I have appeared to you for this purpose, to appoint you to serve and bear witness to the things in which you have seen me and to those in which I will appear to you, delivering you from the people and from the Gentiles, to whom I send you to open their eyes, that they may turn from darkness to light, and from the power of Satan to God, that they may receive forgiveness of sins and a place among those who are sanctified by faith in me. Wherefore, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but declared it first to those at Damascus, then at Jerusalem, and throughout all the region of Judea, and also to the Gentiles, that they should repent and turn to God and perform deeds worthy of their repentance."
He's feeding the reading.
So he went and washed and came back seeing. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar said, "Is not this the man who used to sit and beg?" Some said, "It is he." Others said, "No, but he is like him." He said, "I am the man." They said to him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "The man called Jesus made clay and anointed my eyes and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' So I went and washed and received my sight." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the clay and opened his eyes. The Pharisees asked him how he had received his sight. And he said to them, "You put clay on my eyes, and I washed, and I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not keep the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner do such signs?" There was a division among them. So they again said to the blind man, "What do you say about him, since he has opened your eyes?" He said, "He is a prophet." The Jews did not believe that he had been blind and had received his sight until they called the parents of the man who had received his sight and asked them, "Is this your son, who you say was born blind? How then does he now see?" His parents answered, "We know that this is our son, and that he was born blind. But how he now sees, we do not know. Nor do we know who opened his eyes. Ask him, he is of age, he will speak for himself." His parents said this because they feared the Jews, for the Jews had already agreed that if anyone should confess him to be Christ, he was to be put out of the synagogue. Therefore his parents said, "He is of age, ask him." So for the second time they called the man who had been blind and said to him, "Give God the praise. You know that this man is a sinner." He answered, Whether he's a sinner, I do not know. One thing I know, that though I was blind, now I see. They said to him, What did he do to you? How did he open your eyes? He answered them, I have told you already, and you would not listen. Why do you want to hear it again? Do you too want to become his disciples? And they reviled him, saying, You are his disciples, but we are disciples of Moses. We know that God has spoken to Moses. But as for this man, we do not know where he comes from. The man answered, Why this is a marvel. You do not know where he comes from, and yet you open my eyes. We know that God does not listen to sinners, but if anyone is a worshiper of God and does his will, God listens to him. Never since the world began has it been heard that anyone opened the eyes of a man or blind. If this man were not from God, he could do nothing. They answered him, You were born in our sin. Would you teach us? And they cast him out. Jesus heard that they had cast him out, and having found him, he said, Do you believe in the Son of God? He answered, And who is he, sir, that I may believe in him? Jesus said to him, You have seen him, but it is he who speaks to you. He said, Lord, I believe, and he worshipped him.
Other senses that are really cool. The
soul, I mean, our perception, our awareness, our everything that we see, think, feel, everything of our encounter with this world is through our senses into our soul. And that's all it is for the natural man. Beyond that, he has his imagination, you know, and other things. The spiritual man, the man who has the Spirit of God and presumably lives by the Spirit of God, is informed further by the Spirit of God. So he has also the five senses, the same faculties as the natural man, but he also has his soul being taught, being instructed, being moved in ways by the Holy Spirit. So while the natural man lives pretty much as a natural creature, you know, a physical creature in a physical world, the spiritual man lives as a physical spiritual creature in a creation that truly is physical spiritual. In fact, that's one of the unique properties of man, is that we are designed as, created as physical spiritual beings. We are not merely spiritual beings like the angels, and we are not merely physical beings like the animals, but we bridge the gap. We are the in that perspective, at least on behalf of the physical and the spiritual. But that spiritual man lives with that understanding, that revelation, that true life consists of vastly more than the five senses. And because of this, he lives in a peculiar way. You know, it wasn't Peter that said, we are the peculiar people. Of course, you know, a lot of people told me that. But we don't live strictly by the physical, or at least we're not supposed to. I mean, that depends on how well we're living out our faith, how well we're embracing Christianity or Orthodoxy. But we do not live only for the satisfaction of physical desires and that which we perceive. And in many cases, we deny these things in order to gain something higher in the spiritual realm, putting forth the will of God in all things. The spiritual man does not live for himself alone, but for God who made him. We might call this peculiar lifestyle walking in the Spirit or simply Christianity. But what immense benefit of this manner of life, of living for God, of not living strictly by the senses and satisfying their, you know, their desires, but living by that illumination of the Spirit, is that continuing enlightenment, a progressive enlightenment of the knowledge of God, the seeing of God. The illumination of the soul is crucial in life. But, and I think this is a long-winded point that I'm trying to get to, it's also very crucial in death. Maybe we don't often think about that. But imagine that, well, what happens at the hour of our death? The soul is very much unnaturally separated from the body. Death is not a natural thing, despite what biologists may tell you. It is very much unnatural. We are not made to be separated soul from body, but that happens because of death. And the soul, which has relied on its sensual faculties for perception, or you know, for knowledge, suddenly it's blind. It's cut off. It's blind. It's plunged into darkness. It becomes imperceptive, unable to hear or to speak. You know, I think if some of the fathers have said this, although I think it's pretty obvious, the soul at that hour, at that moment, is terrified. Because, you know, first of all, the experience of being wrenched from the body, and second of all, of being plunged into utter darkness and utter insensibility. It's, you know, it's incredible. It's a frightening thing. Certainly, it's a very unwelcome change to be stuck in this situation. You know, Jesus once referred to hell as a place of outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. that doesn't sound like a nice place. You know, that's not going to be on your agenda, your bucket list, let's say. Although it might be, I hope not. But we can well imagine, you know, this darkness of a soul separated. If it's never learned to be in touch with God, never learned to be illumined by God, suddenly its whole world of pleasures and food and drink and everything else is gone, and there's nothing left. We can imagine weeping of a soul in that condition, realizing all of a sudden it's lost, it's great loss, and feeling that sense of responsibility. But the gnashing of teeth, you know, weeping and gnashing of teeth, our Lord said, now those are two different things. Gnashing of teeth, you know, implies anger, right? So some souls will weep at their loss, others will be angry, will be blaming, you know, perhaps blaming God, perhaps blaming others for their fate. And the great and tragic irony of all of this is that those who have spent their lives seeking only to please themselves, living in effect sensually, putting their needs and their desires ahead of all else, are those who are left with nothing but torment and suffering, because that doesn't carry over into the world to come. He who seeks to find his life will lose it. On the other hand, the soul of the spiritual man, upon its departure from the body, has already developed what the fathers call a theoria, or a vision of God. His soul does not leave the body utterly blind, for though it is no longer connected to the physical senses, it has developed an enduring spiritual perception. It does not find itself in darkness, but surrounded by light. It is not deaf, but hears the singing of the angels and the hosts of heaven. Our dear friend, Father John Livingston, blessed memory, passed away a few years ago. And, his wife was by his side, and his last words were, "I hear the angels." What a beautiful way to repose. But even so, this death, even for the Christian soul, for the illumined soul, is a terror. I mean, it is, you know, the soul is not used to being separated from the body. But this terror for the Christian soul is quickly mitigated by its union with the glorified body of Christ. You know, before this time, between the time of our death and the general resurrection, when our soul will be reunited with our glorified humanity, the soul is left, you might think, without a body. But according to the fathers, it is clothed in the body of Christ. His physical, his glorified body. Because we spend our whole lives nurturing this union and communion with him, partaking of his body and blood, being baptized into his body, so that when we pass, we remain in communion with Christ. And, you know, not as naked souls. And so we see that spiritual sight, cultivating through our prayers, through our abstinence from, you know, the blinding sexual and sensual passions, from our struggles, you know, to be faithful to God, to live and to serve him. This allows our soul to grow in faith and love and spiritual understanding, so that it might be aided in its inevitable journey into eternity. That's a motivator for me. I hope so for you. Think about it. It's not like the TV shows where the hero always wins. You know? There's going to come a time when we're going to lose, and we are going to pass on. And what state will our souls be in at that time? Will they find light and joy and rejoice? Will they hear the angels sing? Or will it be darkness and torment? You know, it's up to us. And it really depends on how we live right now. It's not going to be a surprise. If your soul is dark now, it's going to be dark at the hour of your death. And if your soul is light, then that that's what you'll experience. And this, you know, we live this life, Christian life, this life, this peculiar life, this life of struggle. We, in the eyes of some, will be foolish, but in the end, I think we'd be proven most wise. Others seek only what they can see. We have to seek what we do not yet see, but will. We must refrain from worldliness, from impurity, from selfishness, from miserliness, and, you know, every impurity of soul, thought, and flesh. Blessed are the pure in heart. Why? For they shall see God. You know, it is through the purification of your soul, your heart, your inner person, that your eyes are open to see God. We must desire, above all else in this life, to see God, and also to have the grace to withstand the sight, that everyone will see God, but not all will necessarily enjoy the experience. But what could be more important in this life? With all that we do, you know, our savings accounts, you know, whatever, you know, to have a collection of 142 pairs of shoes, unless to have sneakers, I guess they're useful. Really, what's more important than to pursue illumination, to pursue the sight of God, to pursue that theory, to pursue purity apart? And of course, nothing, we think, in sober moments could ever replace that seeing the sweet face of our Savior. In sober moments, we realize that's the most important thing. Maybe sitting here now, you think, yeah, that's what I'm going to recommit myself to. But then the next temptation comes along, you know, or we just get slothful. And it's not so important. You know, we need to put that gentle beckoning of the Holy Spirit first. You know, He's always there. And He's always telling you, come, pray. Come, keep the fast today. Come, give to that man who needs some money, you know, whatever. Whatever the case may be, He's beckoning also for us to keep our thoughts pure and to struggle, you know, to be kind, to be loving, to be truthful. But we have to remind ourselves in all of this that there's a real, real reason. It's not just, you know, what, getting brownie points. It is either we have spiritual healthy sight or we go blind. And that gift of sight is the most precious of all the senses. That gift of, I mean, that's true enough in the physical sense, but in the spiritual sense, infinitely more so. And we can very easily blind ourselves to God by wrong choices, by living without, you know, proper regard. So I think we can practice also an unhindered, a willing, a joyful even, obedience to Him, seeking out His will. I always love that verse in Scripture that, you know, try and discover, or try and find what is pleasing to the Lord. It's not a bad way to live. But we do this so that we might see, so that we might hear, so that the time of our departure is a time of rejoicing, and that our joy might be made full with the glory of God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Have mercy upon us, keep us, O God, by thy grace, this love.
Let guard and always by thy might, we ask God glory to thee, to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, now and ever and unto ages. Amen.
all of you. May the Lord God remember in his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
For our Father and Metropolitan Joseph and all our brotherhood in Christ, the Lord God, remember that his kingdom, always, now, and ever, and unto ages of ages.
All things good and profitable for our souls and for peace in the world, Let us ask of the Lord.
And this, O Lord.
That we may complete the remaining time of our life in peace and repentance, for a Christian ending to our life, painless, blameless, peaceful, and a good defense before the awesome judgment seat of Christ, let us ask of the Lord.
And this, O Lord.
Calling to remembrance our unholy, immaculate, most blessed and glorious Lady Theotokos and ever Virgin Mary, with all the saints, let us commend ourselves and each other and all our life unto Christ our God.
Spirit.
doubtest in thy kingdom which is to come. For all these things we give thanks unto thee and to thine only begotten Son and thy Holy Spirit. For all things of which we know and of which we know not. And for all the benefits bestowed upon us for manifest and unseen. And we give thanks unto thee also for this ministry which thou hast vouchsafed to receive at our hands, even though there stand beside thee thousands of archangels and thousands of angels, the cherubim and the seraphim, six winged, many eyes, soaring aloft, borne on their wings, singing the triumphal hymn, shouting, proclaiming, and saying,
thank you.
thou grant unto thy holy churches in peace, safety, honor, health, and length of days, and right be abiding the word of thy truth.
Father and to say,
the fear of God, with faith and love draw near.
Blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. God is the Lord and hath revealed himself to us. Our Christ is the Son of God. And set me today as a
thank you.
keep us, O God, by thy grace.
Lord, have mercy.
Asking that the whole day may be perfect, holy, peaceful, and sinless, let us commend ourselves and each other and our whole life unto you, Christ our God.
Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Truly he is risen.
Christ is risen.
Truly he is risen.
Let us adore his holy third day resurrection.
We adore his third day resurrection.
Oh.
great goodness, we pray thee, hearken and have mercy.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Again, we pray for the repose of the souls of the servants of God, and Richard, June, Lorraine, Matthew, Justin, for the Deacon Philip, Lucy, Betty, Oletta, Nell, Shirley, Stanley, Lorraine, Cleta, Kathy, Nadia, Francis, John, Barbara, Wilma, Laura, Mildred, Aunt Nancy, Paul, Mary, and Pat, who are departed this life, and that thou wilt pardon their every transgression, both voluntary and involuntary.
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
That the Lord God will establish their souls with a just repose, the mercies of God, the kingdom of heaven, and remission of their sins. Let us ask of Christ, our immortal King and our God.
Grant this, O Lord.
So pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
O God of spirits and of all flesh, who has trampled down death and made powerless the devil and given life to thy word, do thou the same, Lord, give rest to the soul of thy departed servants, and Richard, June, Lorraine, Matthew, Justin, the Deacon Philip, Lucy, Betty, Olivia, Nell, Shirley, Stanley, Lorraine, Lita, Kathleen, Nadia, Francis, John, Barbara, Wilma, Laura, Mildred, On, Nancy, Paul, Mary, Pat, in a place of brightness, a place of verdure, a place of repose, whence all sickness, sorrow, and sighing have fled away. Pardon every sin which they have committed, whether by word or deed or thought, for thou art good and lovest mankind. For there is no man who liveth that sinneth not, and thou only art without sin, and thy righteousness is to all eternity, and thy law is truth. Thou art the resurrection and the life, and the repose of thy departed servants, O Christ our God, and unto thee be ascribed glory, together with thy Father who is from everlasting, and an all-holy, very life-giving Spirit, now and ever and unto ages of ages. Eternal or ever memorable brethren, who art worthy of blessedness.